great way to begin worship this morning. Bridget Carson has been with us before. She happened to come on a Sunday when I was not here in August. So it's good to welcome Bridget back, and she'll be playing another piece during our kind of anthem time, and then also playing during communion time this morning. So we have the opportunity to hear her several times today, and we're grateful for that. This morning when I looked at my phone, it read 18 degrees, and so those of you who are worshiping with us at home are thinking right now, online worship is a great idea, because a lot of folks did not want to get out on such a cold day. But those who are here, we're certainly glad you're here with us for worship, and welcome. It's a communion Sunday for us, and so those of you at home are invited to participate with communion when we get to that part of the service. And for those who are here, you can kind of stay where you are for right now, but when it comes time for serving communion, we would ask that you move toward the center aisle, because I think we've only got a couple of servers, and it'll make it easier for them to serve communion if everybody's close to the center this morning. A few announcements on your bulletin insert to go over. Session meets, it says 10:45, that's incorrect, 5 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, and we will be down in Gaiman Hall, so we can do some good social distancing there. Because it is a communion Sunday, the green envelopes are available to contribute to the Deacon's Fund if you would like to do that. And then with it being Super Bowl Sunday, we're also collecting cans of soup or other kind of canned food for the food basket ministry. If you didn't bring any of that and would like to make a cash donation, we would accept that as well. I did get one request, though. I don't know who, but some of our folks have been contributing things to the food basket ministry, and they've maybe been contributing some things that have already been opened, like opening up a bag of chips and maybe having a few chips and then sealing up the bag and donating it. Any kind of food that has already been opened, they just throw out. So be sure to know that if you're bringing things for food basket ministry, that it needs to be things that have not been opened yet. And then the cup meal we have scheduled for Thursday, February 25th, so there'll be a sign-up sheet for that. And then one last request, if you haven't already updated your church directory information, email, phone addresses, things like that, please do so, because we're going to be publishing a new church directory very soon. Anybody else have announcements that you need to make today?
Please join me in our call to worship. It's a responsive reading found in your bulletin. Worship God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. The God of creation does not faint or grow weary.
How good is it to sing praises to our God. How expansive is God's understanding of us.
The whole universe is subject to God's power. Creation continues as the universe expands.
God rules all time and space, yet cares about us. God is pleased with all who reflect steadfast love.
Sing to God with great thanksgiving. Praise God with the best you have to offer.
We lift up our eyes to see God's wonders. We open our ears to receive God's message.
Please stand as you are able. Our first hymn is number 305. Come sing, O church, in joy.
Thank you.
with you, ruler of all worlds. Yet we try to order you around when it is we who should be taking orders. At times we act as if we can get along without you. In our church, we often pretend that we don't need other congregations. We hoard the gossip as if it were our possession, and thus we do not follow its mandates. We bend your law to our own whims and then excuse our disobedience. Forgive us, God. We are not worthy to carry the name of Christ. Restore us to yourself, we pray.
Thank you.
Thanks again to Bridget and Sarah for the beautiful music. We spent the second week on some readings from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth. Today our text is from chapter 9, verses 16 through 23. So listen for God's word for us on this day. Yet when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, for I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have a reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge, and so not make use of my rights in preaching it. Though I am free and belong to no man, I make myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. May God bless to our understanding this reading from God's holy word. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. The Apostle Paul was somewhat of a misfit. We don't see it that way, of course. We know Paul is the man who wrote so many letters that make up our New Testament. We think of Paul as legendary. But in his own day, he might have been seen perhaps as a bit of a misfit, at least at one point in his life. After he became a Christian, no one really knew what to do with him, because at first, nobody trusted him. They knew Paul as Saul, the man who went about hunting down, punishing, even killing some Christians for their beliefs. And so when news of his conversion began to spread, there were more than just a few people who were deeply skeptical about what kind of person he really was. He was always having to defend his credentials. You see that throughout his letters. He's always having to defend himself. The first part of today's text is a demonstration of that. But the surprising news here, a little bit, is the context. Apparently, the question that came up that Paul is addressing in this particular part of the letter is, does Paul deserve to get paid for what he does? He's a preacher. He preaches the gospel. And so preachers and congregants alike have their ears perk up a little when the question is, does the preacher deserve to get paid? Well, luckily for preachers, Paul answers that, yes, preachers deserve to get paid. And those of us who are preachers say, that's right, Paul, you tell them. The bad news for preachers is that Paul goes on to say, I'm not going to assert my rights. My preaching will be free. Let's be clear, it's the Apostle Paul saying that, not me. Free preachers wonder, why would he say such a thing? It is because of his sense of call. He feels called to preach the gospel. It is something that he feels like he must do. And he's going to do it whether he is paid or not. Yet, the guy has to earn a living. So what is he to do? Paul earns most of his money from being a tent maker. And that made such a strong impression on the early church all through the ages up to the current day, that anyone who works in the church on a part-time basis and earns their main living in some other way, whether it be as a teacher or a farmer or a lawyer or something else, anyone who just works part-time in the church is seen as having a tent-maker ministry. We still call it that. Many of the early Christian ministers were tent makers of one sort or another. But over the course of time, there grew to be this large professional clergy of which I am a part. But it seems to be circling back around toward that model of tent maker ministry. As churches grow smaller and resources start to dwindle, more and more churches are going to a tent maker model so that they can have a pastor that they can afford, but that earns their primary living, you know, somewhere else. Whether the minister is part-time or full-time, paid or not, all ministers feel that sense of call to proclaim the gospel, to share the good news of God's love with just as many people as they can. That was the goal the Apostle Paul set for himself. He wanted to reach just as many people as he could. Pastor Earl Palmer once said, "We are in sales, not management. Our job is to try to tell the story as widely as we can." And that means reaching out to people where they are. Paul, who perhaps understood what it felt like to be a misfit, reaches out to others who maybe felt like they didn't fit in either. And he gives a list here of the steps he's willing to take in order to meet people where they are. To the Jews, I became a Jew. To those under the law, I became as one under the law. To those not under the law, I became as one not under the law. To the weak, I became weak. Yet the common denominator there is he's trying to reach everybody. You know, you can see just about anybody who might feel like they didn't fit in, included in Paul's list of people that he's trying to reach. Paul specifically targets those who might not feel like they fit in because he wants them to know that they are included among God's people. A number of years ago, when the Duke University men's basketball team won back-to-back national championships, there was a t-shirt that started showing up on campus that was really popular. And on the front of the t-shirt were the words, you know how to talk the game, but do you know how to play the game? And on the back of the t-shirts, the school logo and big words printed out, "We know how to play." Well, some people saw that as a bit arrogant, perhaps because it was coming from Duke. But other people said, you know what? It's not bragging if you can back it up. Well, the Apostle Paul, according to theologian Richard Hayes, is issuing a similar kind of challenge to readers of his letter. He's asking, can we play the game rather than just talk about the gospel rather than just preach the gospel? Can we live out the gospel? Can we sacrifice? Can we exercise discipline in order to play the game of Christianity rightly? To win national championships in basketball, you have to have discipline. You have to give of yourself. You have to know what your role is on the team. The same is true of our discipleship and our efforts to reach other people for Christ. You have to give of yourself, and you have to meet other people where they are. We have talked before about what an intimidating looking building this is for non-church goers. How do we help people get past that in order that they can hear the message of God's love, in order that that message can get through? Well, perhaps too often our attitude has been, well, if they want to become like us, they are more than welcome to join us here. How much more evidence do we need that they don't want to become like us? How do we meet people where they are rather than where we want them to be? We're getting close to the end of the sermon, and you might have noticed that I have thrown out a lot of questions and haven't offered a lot of proposed answers. It's a tough challenge that Paul puts before us. How do you meet people where they are? It takes work. You have to want to do it. Barbara Brown Taylor, on one of the first Sundays after she quit her job as an Episcopal priest, but still was attending worship, had one of the congregants say to her when the worship service was finished, "Welcome to the audience." The Apostle Paul wants to challenge us not to see ourselves as part of the audience, but as part of the team. How do you reach someone who is not a Christian where they are? Well, as a member of the team, how do you plan to do that? Well, amen. Our hymn is number 753 in your hymnals, and I want you to take a look at it before we stand to sing, because this one's just a little bit tricky. It's the one that Lisa actually sang as a vocal solo last Sunday. And if you look in your hymnals, you'll see verse 1 starts and goes about 3/4 of the way down the page. And then you go back to the top of the page for verse 2. And then at the bottom of the page, going on to the next page, is verse 3. And then it goes back to the top of the first page for verse 4. So it's a little bit tricky to follow, but I'm sure that this is a smart group and you'll catch on quickly. So make me a channel of your peace, number 753, and let us stand to sing.
Thank you.
wishes to Earl Gross. Earl's the husband of Dr. Cindy Sherwood. I understand he's in the hospital in Tulsa. There are sympathy cards going out to the families of Pauline Lewis and Curtis Levine. And then a welcome to town letter to Angela Anthony. She is the new director of the Park Zoo and Cemetery. So please be sure to sign those cards on your way out this morning if you haven't already done so. And then on our prayer card for today, just one update to give you. I talked to Joan Goodnight early in the week, and she was just about to be moving. I think they've probably left town by now. Her son Andy, who lives in San Antonio, was going to take Joan down to San Antonio to live with them for a while and kind of see how that goes. She's maintaining her house here at least for a while, but they, with Andy and another brother in San Antonio and then another brother is in Austin, Texas, they'd like Joan a little bit closer to them, and so she's going to move there and see how that works out. So please keep Joan in your prayers as she makes that transition. Any other updates on folks or new prayer concerns today? Okay, Jeff, and then I'll go back to Sarah. And for Jeff, and really for anybody else too, if you would like somebody on the prayer card, just give Alberta a call, and also if you've got their address, and that way, you know, we can send them a card. Sarah.
You keep my sister in your prayers Tuesday. She has knee surgery.
Okay, so Sue Scovel's had knee surgery on which day, did you say?
Tuesday.
In Parsons, I bet.
I'd like you all to keep my sister Lucinda in your prayers. She's having a really rough go of it in Denver. You may know her. She's been here whenever she's in town. She comes to church. This is her church home. And she's just having a very tough time.
About sister Lucinda, just having a difficult time right now. Anybody else?
Oh, and Lisa commented that Jackson has a sprained ACL and is starting physical therapy.
Okay, Lisa Page, kind of an update. You know, we learned last Sunday that Jackson had hurt his knee in a basketball game last Friday night and went to the doctor this past Monday to check that out. A sprained ACL, and so he's started physical therapy on that, and fingers crossed that he might be able to get back and play a little bit before the season ends. Anybody else? All these we will keep in our prayers, in our communion prayers this morning. In Matthew's Gospel we read, "Freely you have received, freely give." Let's spend our offering time thinking about ways in which we might give of ourselves and meet others where they are.
Thank you.
sisters in Christ. The Gospels tell us that on the first day of the week, the day on which our Lord was raised from the dead, he appeared to some of his disciples and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Come then to the joyful feast of our Lord. Please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving and Lord's Prayer as it begins in your bulletin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty Father, creator and sustainer of life, your majesty and power, your continued blessings, and your great goodness fill us with wonder. We are unworthy of the pardon you have in mercy given. We can bring only our thanks, putting our trust in your Son, who alone saves us from evil. Therefore, in joy with prophets, apostles, martyrs, and saints of every time and place, we join in giving you praise. God of glory, in thanks we remember how Jesus broke bread and gave the cup to make us partakers of his body and blood, so that he might live in us and we in him. God of mercy, in thanks we remember how Jesus invites us to his table, imprinting on our hearts his sacrifice on the cross. In gratitude we bow before the righteous one, declaring his resurrection in glory, and knowing that his prayers alone make us worthy to partake of his spiritual being. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that as we receive bread and wine, we may be assured that Christ's promise in these signs will be fulfilled. Eternal Father, lift our hearts and minds on high, where with Christ, your only Son, and with the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, now and forevermore. We especially lift up in our prayers this morning all those who are listed on our prayer card and whose names have been mentioned in the congregation. All of this we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, as I, ministering in his name, now give it to you, saying, This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the body of Christ given for you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. All of you drink of it. And just as a reminder, since we have limited communion servers this morning, I'd ask everyone to kind of move to the center aisle as we serve communion this morning. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you always.